Welcome to the next talk for EHSM. Next up is Clifford Wolf, open software developer. He's worked on some pretty amazing projects, including Rock Linux and OpenSCAD, currently working on Yosys, and that's an open source development system for making your own FPGAs and ASICs, which are hardware for pretty sophisticated hardware chips. So I'll hand it over to Clifford now. Give him a hand.
Thank you. This on now? Yeah. So doesn't really matter. So I will do a one-hour presentation now, and the set of slides I have here is for this one-hour presentation and the 2 hours workshop I will do at 4. So don't be scared by this number of slides here in the bottom right corner. I'm not going to show you 150 slides now in 1 hour. And from this outline, we only cover the first thing here, the introduction. So this should give you a rough idea of what Yosys actually is and what you can do with that. And in the workshop will also be some kind of presentation, so it won't really be hands-on. But in the workshop, I will show you some examples of some more advanced things so you can get a better idea how to implement your own flows with Yosys. So if you consider doing that, using Yosys in your own projects, I encourage you to also join me in the workshop so you get the more practical stuff. And now we are going to cover the basics. So when you design a digital circuit, you usually approach this problem by going down this list of abstraction layers. So you start by thinking about the system level of your design. Usually that's some kind of block diagrams, and here I have a CPU and that talks with this other components. And when you have done that, you go to this high level view where you implement models for the different parts of your systems in some kind of high-level language. And high-level language, in this case, is what a circuit designer thinks is a high-level language. So I'm perfectly aware that when you're a computer scientist, then you might choose a different layer for what is a high-level language and not include something like plain C, maybe. So it really depends on what your design does. What high-level language you would use here. So in when you have some kind of digital filter network, for example, you might use something like MATLAB or Python to model that. But if you design a CPU, you might create a high-level model using C or C++ or maybe even System C. System C is just a C++ library for making this kind of stuff. After that, you go to the so-called behavioral level. And in the behavioral level, you create a cycle-accurate design, a cycle-accurate description of your design using a hardware description language. So there are two hardware description languages that are in wide use. One of them is Verilog, and the other one is VHDL. And Yosys can only do Verilog. So if you happen to know how to write compilers and parsers and that stuff, and are really into VHDL, please write a VHDL frontend for Yosys, because I'm not going to do it, because I'm in love with Verilog. So then you have the register transfer level. And the register transfer level is already more what you would expect from a kind of a digital circuit. Basically, it's the flip-flops you have in your design and the transfer functions that are used to calculate one state, the next state, based on the current state. And one representation of this is, of course, already a netlist, that you have flip-flop cells and then other cells like adders and multiplexers and all that kind of stuff you might naturally use to describe a digital circuit when you don't want to go down to a gate level. So when you have that, you would go to a gate, a logical gate level design. So now you have the same thing. You have the flip-flops and you have the transfer functions. But now you're describing the transfer functions, not using adders and stuff like that, but only simple gates, like an AND gate or an inverter. But the logical in logical gate level means that these are not the gates you actually have in your target architecture. So you might describe all these transfer functions on this level using an AND inverter graph, for example, so just ANDs and NOT gates. But it's possible that you're actually targeting something that doesn't even have an AND gate because it's a pure CMOS architecture where you only have inverting gates like NANDs and NORs. So the last step that is interesting for users is this step from the logical gate level to the physical gate level, where we then look at these functions that are described using this logic, these logical gates, and see how we can map them to the physical world of our target architecture. And if we want to, we can even go to the switch level, where we then look at the individual transistors that make up the circuit. So if I have this stack of these different abstractions, and I go from top to down here, then there is a part that users can do and a part that users can't do. So this step here from the behavioral level, where we have a VHDL or Verilog design, down to a physical gate level, where we have the gates that are available on the target architectures, this is the step you can automate using your synthesis tool like Yosus. You can, of course, also write only this high-level description here and something like C, and then use a high-level synthesis tool to automatically generate Verilog or VHDL from that, and then use a synthesis tool to go from there. So if you want to do that, you only have to manually make this transition from the system level to the high level. In some cases, you can also automate that when you're using, don't know, IP-exact components to build up your system. Then you can just draw a system-level block diagram and are done. So, but Yosus makes this transformation from a Verilog file, because we don't support VHDL, to the physical gate level. The transition from the physical gate level to the individual transistors is then performed by a cell library that is provided by, for example, the fab that you want to use to fabricate your chip. And then simply have a description that says, OK, this NAND gate, for example, consists of this set of transistors. So, in summary to that, basically, what Yosus can do for you, Yosus can process most of Verilog 2005, so most of system Verilog is not supported, and I don't really plan to support a large portion of system Verilog, but I'm going to support some parts of system Verilog. And it can be used to make different kinds of transformations and operations on netlists. It can also do some kind of logic optimizations, but for that I'm basically using another program called ABC from the Berkeley University, and I'm just calling ABC and have export functions to ABC and can then read back whatever ABC did with the design I gave it. So things users can't do. We can't do high-level synthesis. We can't take C, C++, system C, and transform that into a circuit. There are different tools to do that. And users can't create physical layouts. So if you're going to create a chip, for example, it's not only enough to create this netlist. You only need some kind of geometry information where to put each of those gates on the silicon wafer. And you need a different tool to do that. So a typical flow using Yosus would combine Yosus as a HDL frontend with some other kind of tool to make this place and route steps to create the actual physical layouts. One possibility here is Qflow. Qflow is also open source. It's a collection of various programs and a couple of shell scripts that tie them together to create one thing that basically can do that step. Yeah, so when you are using Yosus to do something, you always have this kind of data and control flow. You start here on the left with your HDL design, and then you use some kind of frontend, for example, the Verilog frontend, to transform that into the internal representation Yosus is using. The internal representation of Yosus is called RTLIL, the RTL intermediate language. And then we call multiple commands that somehow transform this intermediate representation. We basically create a script that tells Yosus, execute this step, execute that step. And we, of course, have to write this script in a way so that at the end we have the kind of result we want for the synthesis job we want to perform. And when we are done with that, then we call some backend to create the output format we want to use to go to the next tool in our flow. So actually a very similar picture, just more data-centric or data format-centric. In Yosus, I have two major data formats. One is called AST, of course, that's an abbreviation for abstract syntax tree. But in fact, this representation of the design can do a little bit more than AST. The actual Verilog frontend generates this AST representation. And then there is a second thing called the AST frontend that actually converts that into this RTL intermediate language. There are other frontends that create RTLIL directly, but if you want to support another full-featured HDL, like, for example, VHDL, then one way of doing that would be to also create this AST representation from a VHDL frontend, and then you can share most of the logic that is already there and implemented for handling processes and stuff like that. So then we have this passes that operate on this intermediate representation, and then we are done. We can use one of the backends to convert this intermediate representation to something else. So now I'm going to show you a little example project that you can try out your own. The link to all the files is here. And by the way, if you go to the Yosus website, and it's here on each slide, clifford.at/yosus, then you can also download all these presentation slides, which might be especially interesting if you would like to replicate the experiments I show you in the workshop. So this example project includes three files. There is a synthesis script that creates an ASIC representation of our design. Then the actual design we want to synthesize, and a simple cell library so that the synthesis script actually knows what cells, what kind of gates are available on the target architecture, and which cell type is associated with which cost. So a synthesis script might look something like that. Of course, you start by reading in your design. So here I have read Verilog, and then I read my Verilog file counter.v. And I will show you that in a moment. And when I read in all my design sources, I have to elaborate the design hierarchy. So this command, I can tell what is the top module of my design, and then it throws away modules that are not even reachable from the top module. And it might also rerun the AST frontend if from the top module, another module is instantiated with a different set from parameters than the default parameters. So usually when I write a synthesis script, I first have this block of read Verilog commands, and then I have one hierarchy command. And after that, all bets are off, more or less. So after that, it really depends on what you are trying to do. But if you are trying to do normal synthesis, usually the first command next will be proc, and this one will translate so-called processes to different representations. So when I write behavioral code, not all of the behavioral synthesis is performed by the language frontend. Some is moved to this special command, and these are the kind of features you would like sometimes to have finer control over. So how to interpret HDL code that infers latches or that has asynchronous resets, because handling that kind of stuff has been moved to this different command. You can actually write your own command that runs before that and just transforms the design a little bit so it behaves the way you want. And after that, we call opt. Opt is a command that you will see quite often in YOSU synthesis script. It's just a very, very simple optimizer that makes simple optimizations and cleanups in your design, like throws away wires and cells that are not connected to anything. But even a little bit more advanced optimizations, as you will see later. Yeah, then we call memory. So in an HDL design, I can infer memories. And the memory path is then used to collect all memory ports that belong to a memory, because when you share resources, you could consolidate memory ports. And from the HDL code, it looks like you have a memory with five write ports. But then you do some optimizations, and you realize you never use more than two of them at the same time. And then you can share them. And then the memory path will look at the design and collect all the individual write and read ports for each memory cell, packs that into one cell, and if you don't call it with the dash no map option, like I do here, it will then transform this one cell into a lot of logic and flip-flops and stuff like that. So in some architectures where you actually have dedicated memory resources, like an FPGA with block RAM resources, you probably don't want to do that. In such a synthesis script, we would use this no map option and then use other commands to tell the system what kind of memories can be implemented using the block RAM resources that are available on the target architecture. Yeah, then opt again, then a pass that optimizes some finite state machines, if you have them in your design, and optimize again. And then we map everything to the internal logic gates. So before that, we have adder cells and stuff like that. And after that, we have only logic gates that operate on single bit signals. And of course, that's a good place to optimize again. And in this case, I don't want to retime my design, so I don't want to move flip-flops around in the design to balance the time spent in each of the paths between two flip-flops, so I can easily just map all kind of flip-flops with asynchronous resets and whatever to the stuff on my target architecture here. And the command dff lipmap does that. And the argument to dff lipmap is a liberty file. And the liberty file is just a standardized file format to describe such cell libraries. Then I do logic optimization and actually map the stuff to what I have on my target architecture. I clean up that tiny version of opt. And then I write the results. So the design we are trying to synthesize here is very simple. It's this counter with an asynchronous reset, a synchronous reset and an enable signal. So the counter, So the count output goes to zero if the reset input is high in the clock cycle. it stays the same if the enable input is low and if the enable input is high, and of course reset is low, then it counts up. That's all that the sign does. So that's the cell library we are trying to use. It's a very, very simple CMOS cell library we have here. We have a simple buffer. And you can see the buffer, it's just two NOT gates from the area required. It's just because ABC is much, much happier if the cell library actually contains a buffer cell. So we put one here. Then I have a NOT gate, a NAND gate, a NOR gate, and one kind of flip-flop. So if I would use a completely different kind of flip-flop, asynchronous reset, something like that, synthesis would fail because I don't have a flip-flop cell that I can use to implement that. Usually the Liberty files are much, much larger. They contain ton of timing information and other stuff. But this is already enough. You can do that. But you can't optimize a lot because there is no timing information available. So ABC can only do stuff like reduce the number of logic levels you have. Good, when I run the synthesis script, and we are going through the same commands as we did before now in some chunks. When I run the synthesis script and execute the hierarchy command, this is how the design looks like in memory. I just have one of these proc things that I mentioned before that encapsulate the behavioral code and one adder cell. And if we look at the code again, we see this is the adder. It just ripped the adder out of my always block, and the rest of the always block was transformed into this proc entity. But if I execute proc and opt and memory and opt and FSM and opt, but they actually don't do anything because I don't have memories in these designs and I don't have state machines in these designs. So the only command that actually did something here was proc, and it took this proc entity, this proc cell, and transformed it into actual logic and a flip-flop. So when I call, you can see we still have the adder here, we have a multiplexer here, and the bold lines are used whenever I have something that is not a single bit signal, but a signal with multiple bits. So we see this multiplexer here, for example, is 2 bits wide. And if we execute techmap, we transform this into a representation that is only using single bit gates. So now you can see I have more multiplexers here, but each of them is now a single bit multiplexer. Also, you can see the cell names here. They are all prefixed with a dollar sign that's indicating that this is an internal cell type used by users. And if it's a lowercase thing, it's one of those RTL cells that can be multiple bit wides and do complex stuff like adding and multiplying and dividing stuff. And if they start with a dollar underscore and then a couple of capital letters and then underscore, then it's a 1-bit gate. So, of course, what we are left with to do is to take that design that's using these internal gates that we have available within Yosus and convert that to something that's actually using the cell types that are available in my target architecture. And after that, the design looks like this, and hopefully this is a 2-bit counter with synchronous reset and enable. Okay. So these three slides, I have to admit, was very painful to write because it's really just a very, very small excerpt of all the commands that are available in Yosus. So I had to go over all the things I implemented and make a decision what is important enough to end up on these slides. And I limited myself to three slides. It could have been much more. So, in general, when you are on the Yosus command line, you can use Yosus interactively. You can simply type help, and you get a list of all commands with the single line help message. That's actually the text here. Or you can type help followed by a command name, and then you get a more detailed help message for this command. But you can also, on the just normal Unix shell, call yosus with a dash capital H, and it will give you the whole command list, dash lowercase h followed by a command, and then you will get just this one information. That's sometimes quite useful when you have one terminal open with the synthesis script you are writing, and I just want to look up what the command looks like, then you can save a few keystrokes by not having to go into the interactive mode and then typing help command name. Or you can go to the user's website, because, of course, all the command descriptions are also exported to the web page. So first, I have a couple of commands here that you can use to navigate your design. You can use CD to go into a module and go out again. You can type ls to list the entities in wherever you are. In design level, it's the list of all modules. In the module, it's the list of all cells and wires in that module. And so on. You can also use show, and show actually creates this graphics we have seen before. So if you go to the link I had on the slide before with the scripts, you will see that the actual script used is a little bit longer than the one I did show you, because it contained those commands interleaved with show commands with a bunch of parameters to create PDFs and stuff like that. So there are a couple of commands to help you work on the shell. You can, whenever you are in the synthesis script, you can just call the shell command and you go into interactive mode. You can type history to see what commands you have executed. That's, of course, useful if you try something out interactively and then think, OK, yeah, that's actually a quite good synthesis strategy. Let's just copy and paste that to my synthesis script, and you type history with script, you can execute a script you have laying around. And I also embedded tickle, so if you don't want to just call one command after each other, but actually like to have control structures in your synthesis script, you can, of course, use tickle. So there are a couple of commands for reading design files. You can, of course, also read and write elang files, and that's just the text representation for RTL-IL. So when you're writing code for users, for example, this write elang is quite helpful, because it will give you a one-to-one representation of how the design looks like in memory. Hierarchy we've seen, proc, FSM, memory, opt, all commands we have seen. Also the ones here at the bottom for technology mapping, we have seen some of them, but of course, there are some things we didn't need for this one example, but you need in some environments, like high-low map. In some architectures, you have special cell types that output a 1 or a 0, and with that you can tell it, okay, now use this, I don't know, VCC and GND cells, for example, to create this constant. You can use IO pad map to insert IO cells into your design. So this IO pads usually are special cells, and quite often you want to introduce them in the synthesis script and not necessarily write them in your HDL code. And of course, a couple of backends. This BTOR thing, by the way, is the only thing in Yosus I didn't write myself. So I'd really like to change that. So I'm very willing to add other stuff to Yosus, just send a pull request on GitHub. And the Yosus source tree is organized in a way that makes it very, very easy to isolate the different commands and subsystems from each other. So it's very easy to write something that doesn't disturb anyone if he's never calling that command you just implemented. Then I would like to say there are many, the plural, but actually that's the only one. This synth Xilinx thing automatically synthesizes the design for Xilinx 7 series FPGAs and creates an EDIF file, and then you can use that to go into the Xilinx place and route tools, or write your own place and route tool. And the idea is to create more of this synth underscore something commands for other application domains. Yeah, and then there are stuff like model checking that are implemented in Yosus that I'm going to show in more detail in the workshop. So I have just a couple of more Verilog examples for those here who don't know Verilog, just to show off some of the things you have to implement when you write a synthesis tool. So this is a little design that can detect if a 5-bit input is a prime number. And how does it do it? It just creates a lookup table. That's the lookup table. And the lookup table is initialized in this block that needs to be executed by the synthesis tool to find out what number below 32 is a prime number and what is not. So another thing where we have for loops and stuff that are executed by the synthesis tool, this time it's using the generate keyword. So the code here is instantiated multiple times using this for loop, and this is just the ripple carry adder that you can parameterize to whatever width you'd like to have for your ripple carry adder. And that's a content addressable memory, like you would use for caches, for example. Once again, I put the for loop here, but this time it's a for loop in an always block. So in the initial block, it's quite clear that's not code that really describes the circuit. It's a description what the synthesis tool should do to find out the initial values of stuff. And here in an always block that actually describes circuitry, this is a loop that is just unrolled by the synthesis tool to create many instances of this block here, always with other eyes for each iteration. So of course, I don't support everything in Verilog 2005. I support a huge part. I support most of it. But I don't support arrays with more than one array dimension. If you ask me, that's something that you shouldn't use in synthesizable code anyways. But it's not supported yet. If there is a good argument to support and they have the time, I'm also happy to do it. But there are other to-do items, and I thought that one is not so important at the moment. Also related to arrays, so memories that are inferred by the design, is writing to arrays, of course, is supported, but writing to arrays using bit and part selects is not. So a usual application for that would be to write a memory that has byte enables, for example. And at the moment, this doesn't work and creates a quite obscure error message because it already triggers a parser error, I guess. But this is on the to-do for the 0.4 release. In order to do that, I have to change the internal representation of memories. I didn't want to do it for the 0.3 release. Then there are this rather obscure wired OR and wired AND wire types that have been introduced in Verilog 2005. I don't support them. And I don't support tri-state logic. So if anyone makes a really good argument for tri-state logic, I can look into what I can do for that. In my opinion, tri-state logic is really a legacy thing in digital design nowadays. So then latched logic, that you also shouldn't have in your designs, of course, is basically supported, but it's supported in a way that you really don't want it. It creates feedback loops in your logic path. So that's also something that would need improvement. So I would really say I support code that infers latches. And then there are some non-synthesizable features in Verilog that should be ignored by a synthesis tool. And I think I haven't caught all those places. So if you find something like that, just file a bug report, and I will happily add something to the parser that is ignored. Good. So that was Yosus, the program itself, but it's very important, especially when you do stuff with ASIC designers. ASIC designers are scared all the time. you need to verify whatever you do and show that it really works and doesn't screw up in the wrong place at the wrong time. So I spent some time on verifying the correctness of Yozus, and for that, of course, there is a make test in Yozus that has about 200 test cases. I recommend to only use that when you have the most recent version of Icarus Verilog installed, because I found a few bugs in Icarus Verilog, and they haven't been fixed in the last release, I think, so you need the GitHub checkout. But I have two external tools as well. One is called Vloghammer, and the other one is called Yozus Bixim. Vloghammer is something that randomly generates valid Verilog code. Looks something like that. Thousands and thousands of such lines, thousands of thousands design files. And then I use these designs with a wide array of tools. I use a couple of commercial tools. I use a couple of freely available tools. I use a couple of simulators and synthesis tools. And I see if they all agree about how this code should be interpreted. And I found quite a few bugs in Yozus using this approach. But I also found quite a few bugs in the other tools. The proper tools are not necessarily better than the open source tools in this domain. So at the moment, I think it's over 50 bugs that I have been reported. The ones in the open source tools, I think, are all closed by now. And I think the ones in the commercial tools, none is closed by now. So Xilinx mailed me a week ago that they have now fixed one of the 8 bugs I reported for Vivado in the current development version. But I reported it in December last year. So the other thing is Yozus Bixim. So of course, with stuff like that, I catch some quite interesting and quite obscure bugs. But also, stuff like that doesn't cover all of the Verilog language features. So I also need to use real-world designs. So I created this Yozus Bixim package that's just a collection of real-world open-source Verilog designs with test benches. And I run the test benches on the original HDL code on the synthesis result and see if they behave exactly the same. And they do, at least most of the time. If not, then I have to fix another bug. So I have another few slides about the benefits of having this infrastructure as open source and not just as closed source. Of course, an argument that usually comes up as first or very early is the cost. Many people would say that cost is not such a big issue if you do ASIC design, because it's so expensive to fab your ASICs anyway. But if you're looking at something like a 180-nanometer process node, and there are still a lot of fabs that offer a 180-nanometer process node, you easily pay more for your design tools than you pay for your process masks. So I think that something like this is also a very, very big enabler for open source hardware in that kind of domain, because now that the 180-nanometer process node becomes more and more reasonably priced, it also becomes interesting to actually have programs to design for those processes. So, and another very important thing is the availability of the tool and the ease of reproducing experiments. So if you're a researcher and you, don't know, come up with some fancy algorithm to do something with a netlist, and you would like to publish a paper about it, now when you look about these papers, like someone, don't know, invented a method to optimize finite state machines, then you find this sentence, ah, we used this version of Cadence or Synopsys or whatever tool to create the netlists for our tests. And that's That's not really reproducible. Even if your university happens to have a license for exactly that tool, you usually don't have exactly that version available. But if it's an open source tool, you can either even republish the source you have used to generate your netlists in the first place. And of course, that's a big advantage. Another thing is this framework aspect. Now, there's a lot of stuff in Yozu, so it's easier if you add something new to benefit from the stuff that is already there. And you can create one tool that really covers a huge application domain. So in the commercial world, often tools are split up into parts just for business reasons. Because it's really, really hard to sell a tool that can do everything because it would be so expensive. So you buy a synthesis tool, and then you buy a formal equivalence check tool, and so on and so on. Even though a synthesis tool and the formal equivalence check tool share really a lot of what they need to do to perform their job. And with an open source code base, you can just create a tool that reuses that common code bases, and then you have something that can do whatever you want it to be. And also, it's very important as an educational tool, because most commercial synthesis tools are black boxes. And you drop something in, you get a lot of messages usually, and then you get something out. In some cases, you can say, show me the RTL netlist, but you can't just, don't know, add printfs to the code and see what the algorithm is doing and why the extractor for DSP cells isn't recognizing this algebraic operations as something that can be matched to a DSP slice. You can't easily see how it's been done in the cases where it works, and therefore it's really hard to understand why it doesn't work in other cases. So this is really nice. Also, Yozu is under the ISC license. This is the whole text of the ISC license. That's what I like about it. It's really clear what it should do. It's basically equivalent to the two-clause BSD license. I think it's even a little bit shorter. So for me, the most important thing is that people are actually using my code. I'm delighted if someone sends me patches. I'm delighted if someone tells me what they are doing with it. But if someone wants to use that in their commercial tool, never tell me about it. I'm perfectly fine with that, because I wrote that so that people can use it. So what would be typical applications where you could use Yozu? Of course, the obvious answer is you can synthesize your designs with it, and then you have something you can fabricate in case of an ASIC, for example. But you can also use it for a pre-production synthesis. So like in the software world, you not only compile your product when you ship the release, you compile it a lot during the day. And likewise, when you design digital logic, you not only synthesize it once at the very end of your design process, you synthesize it a lot on the way. And maybe it's much easier for you to get the venture capital at the end of the process to buy a commercial tool that you need, when you have already something to show that works, and have already something that can do ASIC synthesis, and therefore gives you good estimates of how well your design performs on an ASIC architecture. You can also use it to convert full-featured Verilog to really simple Verilog. There are a couple of other open source tools out there that claim to support Verilog, but actually they only support a very, very small subset. So you could use Yozu as kind of a preprocessor for those tools. Or you could use it as a front end for other flows that exist already, that, for example, work on the BLIF file format, on the BTOR file format. So BLIF is a very common file format for open source logic synthesis tools. And BTOR is a not yet so common format, but it's maybe becoming more common for symbolic model checking and stuff like that. Yeah, for educational purposes, you can just use Yozu to demonstrate synthesis and to show students, for example, how HDL code relates to the netlists and what algorithms are used to make this transformation. You can use it as a framework for experimenting with new algorithms. So you don't need to write your own front end and whatever just for making your own logic mapper. And you can use it, of course, as a framework to build your own complete custom flow. And I know people are also doing that. It's the next slide. So of course, I don't know everything people do with it, because you can just take it and do with it with whatever you want. But some stuff I know. So there is this PhD project. And you see my name in the publication. So obviously, I knew about that one. That was actually the main motivation for me to write Yosos in the first place, that we wanted to do research on coarse grain synthesis and realized that we can't use any existing tool. So I just wrote my own. And this is an example of a complete custom flow. Synthesis script that look completely different from what I have shown you before. Then I know several groups that are using Yosos as a front end for something that pre-existed already and used BTOR or BLIF. And before they used Yosos, they could only test it on small artificial designs. And now they can test their flows on basically everything that is Verilog. And I know some analog designers who actually have access to the commercial tools and have knowledge how to use these commercial tools, but say they are using Yosos when they are just creating a small control circuit for the digital thing, because it's much easier to do it that way than to use a huge second framework just for creating the small state machine you happen to have in your analog design. And then there is also eFabless. So eFabless is a company that tries to make a 180-nanometer process node available at a very, very cheap price, as a price that would be affordable for hobbyists. And 180-nanometers, that's the original Pentium CPU was created in this process. So it's huge for today's standards, but you can do reasonable stuff in 180-nanometers. It's very important to them that they say they are not an EDA company. They want to make all the stuff they make open source on the software side. They are only interested on being a kind of middleman between the people who want to do designs and the fabs that actually can fabricate them. They have a web-based design environment. I had the honor to try a beta of that. It's quite interesting. And they're using Yosos for the HDL design and the custom place and route tool they wrote, and that they are planning to release when it's finished. Yeah, supported platforms. So I'm using Kubuntu 14.04. So if you happen to use that, it's basically guaranteed that you can just compile Yosos out of the box. But of course, you can use more or less any up-to-date Debian, and it should work. If you are on another Linux distribution and you're trying to compile it and they get some obscure C++ compiler error messages, it's probably because I'm using some of C++ 11 features. And if you have an older compiler, it might not support that yet. So if you get stuck, have a look at the Yosos subreddit, where we have that instead of a mailing list. When you're lucky, you will already find your platform there when you look at the old posts. But if not, just post something, and either someone will post in a day a solution, or I will install the distribution you're using in the virtual machine and see if I can give you the two lines fixed that you need to get users running. There are ports to Mac OS X and to OpenBSD, but there is no port to Windows yet. And this yet doesn't mean that I'm going to do it, but that I'm hoping that maybe someone thinks that it's important enough to do it. So, some other tools I'd like to mention. Of course, there is Icarus Verilog, which is a synthesis, which is a simulation tool. Then there is Qflow. I mentioned that already, which is just an open source flow for the place and route parts. And then there is ABC, the tool I'm using to do logic optimization. So what can you do for our project, for my project? So as an user, of course, you can use Yosys on your own project. And I don't expect now everyone to use it in production and actually create production silicon with it. But just try it on the way and see if it can handle your design. And if it can't, go to the subreddit and post something. And I'm always happy to see when people find bugs in Yosys in non-critical situations in the timeline of a project. So you are helping me and others really a lot if you're doing that and reporting bugs. Yeah, join the discussion, report bugs. Yeah, as a developer, so say you are researching in circuit synthesis, you could consider using Yosys as a framework that you use to write your own code in, so you don't need to replicate the work that is already in there, like HDL frontends and all that stuff. And there are two ways to do that. You can either fork the project on GitHub, but Yosys also supports pluggable modules, so you can compile your own command in a .so file and then just load it at runtime. Yeah, and of course, we need a VHDL frontend, so if anyone wants to write a VHDL frontend. Okay, we have a website, we have documentation there, we have the subreddit that I mentioned already, and the direct link to the source code, of course, the most important thing of them all. There are a lot of documentation on the website, but there is also a README file in the source code, so if you just want to give it a quick try, I try to stick with the README file first because it's much, much shorter and it even contains a Hello World example that you can just try. So, in summary, Yosys is a very powerful tool and it's a framework for Verilog synthesis, and it must be a framework because when I say Verilog synthesis, the obvious question is synthesis for what? So, in order to support a really wide field of possible architectures, it must have this framework characteristic, and there is this command line interface, or you can also write scripts to then combine all these features and commands that are available in Yosys to do exactly the synthesis job you want to do. And then the workshop that will start in about 1 hour, I will show you more advanced examples and how to write synthesis scripts that map block RAMs and map arithmetic functions to DSP blocks and all the really funny stuff. Okay. Are there questions?
Any questions? Yeah.
Hi. So you mentioned there's a Xilinx backend. Is it reasonable to expect to synthesize, for example, Milky Mist or something using Yosys, or is that far in the future?
I'm not sure about the whole Milky Mist system. I can synthesize the LM32. But you might need to change a couple of things in your code and then directly instantiate stuff like block RAMs, because the existing Xilinx backend only generates flip-flops and LUTs. So I'm not using the memory features yet that are available in M slices, and I'm not using DSP cells, and I'm not using block RAMs out of the box. But that's, of course, on the to-do list.
Right. So I tried to lead into how difficult is it to support other platforms of FPGAs, for example. How much, who can do that?
If it's if you just want to target the LUTs and not start mapping DSP blocks and stuff like that automatically, then it's quite simple. Because you just run abc-lot and then give it the number of inputs the lot on the architecture has. And then you create, that creates an internal netlist that uses $lut cells. And then you can write a really, really simple techmap script that just says, take these LUT cells and instead replace them with however these LUT cells look like at the target architecture.
And then we need to know how the bitstream actually looks for the target architecture.
Yeah, and before that, we need to know how the interconnect works and stuff like that. Yeah. But I'm in touch with two projects that are trying to reverse engineer two different kinds of programmable devices. At the moment, so I'm hoping that we will see more in that direction in the future.
Question.
If I understood it correctly, the front end, the Verilog front end, generates the AST code or representation, and this is where you also would see an VHDL front end attach.
Yeah.
Now, the question is twofold. First, if somebody decides to write such an VHDL front end for the AST interface, would the resulting design allow to convert VHDL to Verilog? Because is it possible to write out the ASDL? AST.
There's actually a feature in the AST front end to dump Verilog. It's only used for debug purposes. So there are some things that I dumped that are technically not Verilog, but are easier to recognize when you look at it. So you could go that direction. The big question is always how it performs in all the obscure corner cases when you, so especially asynchronous resets. Are already differently defined in the Verilog synthesis standard and in the Verilog simulation standard. So in simulation, on an asynchronous reset, you always react to the clock edge. And in synthesis, of course, you then react to the level, which is not quite what you modeled. So when you don't look at these corner cases and just say, the obvious simple stuff where I don't need to know all the details in the standards, I could use it to translate VHDL to Verilog. There is one tool that is free as in FreeBeam that can do it, that. And I'm not really convinced of that tool. So that would be another possibility, of course, to just go and write a VHDL to Verilog front end and then don't bother to support it directly in user. There is even a read underscore VHDL to Verilog command that you can use to use this existing converter to use a VHDL file. And there is also a read verific frontend that's using the verific library to load HDL code. So that supports much more than of system Verilog than I do. And it supports VHDL, but it's a commercial library. And there are only 80 companies, I think, worldwide that have licenses to it.
OK. And the second part is the intermediate language, the AST, which is not the actual internal representation, but the early stage representation I got from the explanation. Is it well documented? So is it easy to write such a front end? Or would somebody who writes an VHDL front end have to figure out how the language actually works?
So there is a manual for users. And the user's manual contains a lot of documentation for the internals. It also contains a documentation for the EST front end, but not for all of the details in it. So the AST representation, there's one class, it's called AST node, and it has a list of children. And the simple cases are all documented, but when you go to the more sophisticated stuff, you might have to use some trial and error and see what AST tree is generated from the Verilog frontend for a specific input. But it's not completely undocumented. They let me do that for my bachelor thesis, so I had to document that as well.
Okay, so we're out of time now. So thank you, Clifford, for that.